Good morning. Welcome to the bridge. Love to hear all of the chatter. Means we're visiting and getting to know each other better. Anyway, we're glad you're here this morning. And as you can tell, it's a little warm outside. Going to be a warm day. Glad it's cool in here. And Stephen and Daria and the twins are still in Poland. And we're going to bring you a few more photographs here. If you'll just run these as I tell you to. The town that is Daria's hometown is called Torn, Poland, and it's up towards the north in the center of Poland. It's a town about 300,000 with the surrounding area. And the first picture is coming here. The good news, you see somebody you recognize in there, Erica. Erica and her friend Allie. They caught up with Stephen and Daria in Poland, and I obviously recognize the twins there. And then this here is the picture of Stephen and Daria and the twins, obviously, but they are at Speedway, and Speedway is one of the things, sporting events in the town, and it's actually motorcycle racing, and each town has a team, and they visit each other's towns, and the good news is Torin won that night, so. And this is Edek. Edek is their grandpa, Daria's dad. And in Polish, he's known as Jadzusz. And just so you know, I give fair treatment to grandmas too. Grandmas are babush or babcha. And she's not in the picture here so this time. And then wanted to make sure everybody understood that Stephen is still attending church while he's away from us. But you can see Benny and Sophie in a cathedral there. Benny's just amazed looking up. It's a great picture. But if you look closely at Sophie, she wants to get a really close-up view. She actually has binoculars there. And then last week we showed you a picture when they were chasing the pigeons. I just wanted you to know they did catch up with them here. And they are sharing some food with them. And they actually come and land on their hands and eat from them. And Stephen says there's a whole lot of things they like about being in Poland, but this is definitely one of their favorites here. And that's it. Okay, very good. Thank you. And this morning, we're going to be blessed by having Nick bring the message. And I just want to take a moment to acknowledge Nick for all he does for the bridge. The technical side that goes flawlessly here. I know he has some help this morning and other weeks as well. But he keeps that going for us. The emails that you receive, and if you're not on the email list, that's a good suggestion that you do that, because just about everything you want to know about the bridge is on there, and he's kept that going. He's been with us as part of the core team and also leads the youth ministry here. So if you have children youth age, he's the guy you want to talk to. So Nick, we just want to acknowledge you for all of the support you give to the bridge. And Nick is going to bring a message today. You know, I've never seen this done before, but he's going to cover a whole book of the Bible in one message. Good news, it's Obadiah, and a very short book. Just in case you look, it's only one chapter, and you have to look hard in the Bible. It's between Amos and Jonah, page 772, because I always need help. So, Nick, we look forward to hearing the message. We've been praying for you this week. And thank you for your willingness to do this. Please stand, greet one another, and we'll get started with worship.
Good morning.
The song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. So God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. Let it rise above the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sounds. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. All of the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. All of the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory.
Good.
All the time.
Deuteronomy 32, verse 3 and 4 says, "For I will proclaim the name of the Lord, ascribe greatness to our God, the rock. His work is perfect, for all his ways are justice, a God of faithfulness and without iniquity, just and upright is he." And boy, he is. God is so good. He didn't say, "I'm God and you're humans. Good luck." He said, "I'm God. I'm going to put a cleft in my son, the rock, where you can hide yourself in anything, anything you're going through, anything." So let's sing Rock of Ages.
Duh. could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? These for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou alone. Nothing in my hands I bring, simply to the cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless but wash me, Savior, or I die. Wash me, Savior, or I die. Wash me, Savior, or I die. While I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes in death, when I rise to worlds unknown and behold thee on thy throne, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee, let me hide.
Praise God.
Praise God. Well, this is the time where the kiddos get to skedaddle on back to class, birth through fifth. Actually, we're really thankful for the kids here at the Bridge. They're a blessing to all of us, and it's a true sign to us that we have a good God to give us such beautiful and wonderful children, and the way He's working in their hearts here at the Bridge is amazing, and I've got a glimpse of that sometimes at some of these events that they have for the kids, and it's just amazing to see how God's working in their hearts. So as they go back to the class, we're going to pray for them that God just brings joy to their hearts as well. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for the blessing of these children that you bring upon us and that you just so blessed us with. And Lord, we're thankful for the way that you're just growing them with you and bringing them close to you and, you know, giving them hearts of joy and letting Jesus just shine through them as well. So, Lord, we just pray that you be with the teachers today and that you just send your message to the kids as well as we get to hear your word today. So, Lord, we just lift them up to you and just thank you for the joy that you display through them. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, before we do this next song, I'd like to turn to Hebrews 4:16. It says, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need." And that's what we're here for today. Every time we step into a place of worship, like the sanctuary we're in this morning, we come before the throne and seeking God's grace and His mercy in the situations and the time of need that we're in. And we have a good God, and we should be thankful all the time that we can always turn to Him, and He's always there to bless us with His grace, even though we don't deserve it. And He sent His Son Jesus to die for us. We didn't deserve that. While we were still sinners, He died. And so I just rejoice daily that we can enter into the throne room and go before God and expect that His grace will be there. And I'm so thankful for it. Amen.
strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end of all my sin. Because a sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the one, risen Son of God, hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the one, risen Son.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you for giving your grace and your mercy. God, we're so glad that we can come before you, that we can walk into the temple and enter into the throne room, and we can lay our prayers at the feet of the cross and bow before you and petition everything that's on our heart. And God, some are here today to give praise. God, some are here today that have need. God, you know everything about us, and you know everything that's going on in our lives. And there's nothing that slips by you, God. Not one thing on each and every one of us here. And God, I just thank you that you are a big God. You are a great God. And God, I'm so thankful that we can turn to you. We can praise you, God. We can thank you, God. We can rejoice with you, God. We can sing your praises. We can worship you. And then, God, I know that we can fall on our knees and we can cry out to you, God. We can call on you, Lord, when we're scared and when we're lost. And, God, when we don't know where to turn and when the world's closing in on us and the weight of the world and the weight of our daily lives is pressing down on us, God, you're always there. And we can always turn to you, and, God, you will take that burden from us. And you said that the yoke was light. So, God, I just thank you today that as Nick comes to give us the word, that, God, it will penetrate our heart and it will lift us up and it will give us hope and it will give us joy. And God, I just thank you that you hear our prayers and you're in the midst of our presence now, because where it says you dwell in the praises of your people. God, we invite you into this service this morning, and we pray for your anointing on Nick as we're excited to hear the word that comes forth today from his mouth, your word, your voice, out of that empty vessel. And I thank you, God, for Nick, and I just pray, Lord, that it be a blessing on this crowd, this congregation today, in Jesus' name. Amen.
So I want to apologize real quick. We actually got one more song, so that's probably my bad. But if you guys, you know, need to sit down, it's okay. It's really cool. But we got one more song. And actually, we have a scripture that goes before that song, so bear with us here. In Galatians 4:4-7, it reads this. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoptions as sons. Because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into your heart, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then that means you're an heir of God, so a child of God, which that just fills me. I mean, that's amazing to know that we've been adopted children, that God loves us so much that he sent his only son to bring us home, to be one with him, you know, not of this flesh anymore, but of his spirit, of him, so we can live in him. So when we go to this song, let's sing it, as I've heard once with gusto, but let's sing it knowing that we are children of God and that we walk with God. He walks alongside of us. So, and if you can't stand anymore, go ahead and sit down. It's okay.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance. From my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Child of God, I'm no longer
I'll go ahead and transition this one. Don't apologize. That song, don't let Matt take the blame. I was the one. You can go ahead and sit. I was the one who wouldn't let him scratch the seventh song of the service, just because there's no better sermon that I could preach than what we just heard in that song. It's almost like Obadiah wrote it, to be honest. And sorry, I'm distracted. I just saw a note somebody wrote for me. Whoever wrote this, thanks. I think I know, but that's awesome. Obadiah, I don't know if you guys have ever heard of him, or somebody asked me last week what I was going to preach on. I said, Obadiah, and she said, who? And I said, actually, he's got a book that he wrote, and it's in the Bible. So I've got a little video I want to show you guys, and my wife told me it was insanely cheesy, and so that's fine. She can have her own opinion. I think it is too, but I also think it's funny. So let's go ahead and show that video real quick, if you can.
Two illnesses that have reached epidemic proportion today are pridefulitis and opinionasia. And many have lost hope.
Symptoms include hearing loss, anger, the urge to debate, and delusions of not needing directions.
I see pridefulitis every day in my practice. It destroys friendships, marriages, and careers.
Sufferers can find it impossible for any advice or helpful input.
But now there's hope. Introducing Humilify.
After just a few days on Humilify, I was actually able to hear my spouse again. Humilify saved my marriage.
I suffer from full-blown, nag-resistant pridefulitis. Humilify completely cured my hearing and my vision. Humilify gave me hope.
Humilify has also been shown to be effective against other diseases, like I'm the victimitis, get off my caseus, and I know bestia.
Exercise caution. Side effects include sincere apologies, attentive listening, and the realization that other people are intelligent. Make the decision that will change your life. Try Humilify today. Humilify. Isn't it time you swallowed your pride?
Cheesy or not, it's still funny. So, we have free packets in the back on your way out if you'd like any. We've got a... Yeah, anyway, I'll just leave that there. This book, I can't tell you how excited I am to preach out of it. It's a book that I know fairly well. I did a report on it one time in school, and I'm kind of obsessed with the Minor Prophets, to be honest. The worship team gave me a lot of grief this week at practice and stuff like that, just because I would read them random scriptures from the book and be all, I think the word is, geeked out about it, and I just love it a lot. A world-renowned preacher I once heard say that he would write his sermon, and after he wrote it, he would dumb it down until he almost felt embarrassed to preach it, and then he felt like he was prepared. I'm not going to say his name because I don't really agree with that wholeheartedly. I get where he's coming from. But I sincerely feel like when we are preparing to deliver the Word of God, preparation is a must, and feeling inadequate to preach God's Word is something that should just come naturally. And so I'm telling you that just to say that right now I'm standing here and I feel pretty dumb compared to God's Word. So take that for what it is. That's what I got. So Obadiah, like Tom said, it's right between Amos and Jonah. It's about halfway through your Bible, so if you just flip halfway, you might get lucky. I think he told you the page number. I forgot what it was, but that's where it is. It is the shortest book in the Old Testament. It's only 21 verses, so don't get too upset that I'm going to preach on the whole thing. And it's what's really funny is it's twice as short as the second shortest book, Haggai. It represents less than a hundredth of the Bible. It's that small. It's not only the shortest book in the Bible, but the author we know virtually nothing about. His name means servant of the Lord. There are 11 different Obadiahs mentioned in the Bible because it's a very common name back then, but we have no evidence or support to even know if he is one of them. And so Obadiah, interestingly enough, was a nobody in the world of that time, just like me. So, but we do know one true thing, one very important thing. Obadiah spoke the word of the Lord, and he did it, in my opinion, very well. I'm going to break this book into two sections. A lot of people break it into three and even four, but I'm going to use my own pride, I guess, and break it into two. Verses 1 through 16 is the first part we're going to look at, and then verses 17 through 21. And that first section is basically just against, it's Obadiah's speaking the word of the Lord against the nation of Edom, who lived in a land just southeast of the Dead Sea. And I'm not too sure if you guys have studied up on your Bible geography, but the Dead Sea was southeast, or Edom was southeast of the Dead Sea and Jerusalem was northwest. And so they were directly across the Dead Sea from Jerusalem. And that'll be important, we'll see later. Verse 17 through 21 is the deliverance of Israel, the main theme of the Old Testament and God's establishment of his kingdom here on earth. The main point of the book, I think, is that it's an encouragement to God's people that despite the fact that they are in exile, Judah is in exile right now, that God is providing them a way of escape. And that's very important to us as well. And that he's still the master and he's still in control and the creator of our universe. Also that wrongs will be righted and he will establish his whole kingdom and cover us basically in safety throughout. So let's go ahead and read it. I'm going to go straight through, and I'll also kind of reread some sections as we go through. Obadiah, the vision of Obadiah. Thus says the Lord concerning Edom, we have heard a report from the Lord, and a messenger has been sent among the nations. Rise up, let us rise against her for battle. Behold, I will make you small among the nations. You shall be utterly despised. The pride of your heart has deceived you, you who live in the clefts of the rock. In your lofty dwelling, who say in your heart, who will bring me down to the ground? Though you soar aloft like the eagle, though your nest is set among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord. If thieves came to you, if plunderers came by night, how you have been destroyed. Would they not steal only enough for themselves? If grape gatherers came to you, would they not leave gleanings? How Esau has been pillaged, his treasures sought out. All your allies have driven you to your border. Those at peace with you have deceived you. They have prevailed against you. Those who eat your bread have set a trap beneath you. You have no understanding. Will I not on that day, declares the Lord, destroy the wise men out of Edom and understanding out of Mount Esau? And your mighty men shall be dismayed, O Teman, so that every man from Mount Esau will be cut off by slaughter. Because of the violence done to your brother Jacob, shame shall cover you, and you shall be cut off forever. On that day you stood aloof, on the day that strangers carried off his wealth, Judah's wealth, and foreigners entered his gates and cast lots for Jerusalem, you were like one of them. But do not gloat over the day of your brother and the day of his misfortune. Do not rejoice over the people of Judah in the day of their ruin. Do not boast in the day of distress. Do not enter the gate of my people in the day of their calamity. Do not gloat over his disaster in the day of his calamity. Do not loot his wealth in the day of his calamity. Do not stand at the crossroads to cut off his fugitives. Do not hand over his survivors in the day of distress. For the day of the Lord is near upon all nations. As you have done, it shall be done to you. Your deeds shall return on your own head. For as you have drunk on my holy mountain, so all the nations shall drink continually. They shall drink and swallow and shall be though they had never been. But in Mount Zion, there shall be those who escape. And it shall be holy. And the house of Jacob shall possess their own possessions. The house of Jacob shall be a fire. And the house of Joseph a flame. And the house of Esau, stubble. They shall burn them and consume them, and there shall be no survivor for the house of Esau, for the Lord has spoken. Those of the Negev shall possess Mount Esau, and those of the Shephelah shall possess the land of the Philistines. They shall possess the land of Ephraim and the land of Samaria, and Benjamin shall possess Gilead. The exiles of this host of the people of Israel shall possess the land of the Canaanites as far as Zarephath, and the exiles of Jerusalem who are in Sepharad shall possess the cities of the Negev. Saviors shall go up to Mount Zion to rule Mount Esau, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's. Father, we come to you today humble that your word is for all nations, for all tribes, for all tongues. That your word provides us with a deliverance and the truth of it, an escape into your arms. God, you are so good, and we pray that today your truth just rings out in this place. God, take me, remove me from this, and just make it you. In Jesus' name. Amen. So part one here, we see all throughout Scripture that God has been patient with Esau and his descendants, the land of Edom more specifically. All throughout Scripture, this battle has been going on. I'm going to read something from Numbers 20. I didn't give this to the guys, so this is my fault. This is an example of God has continued to be patient with them. It says, Moses sent messengers from Kadesh to the king of Edom. Thus says your brother Israel, you know all the hardship that we have met, how our fathers went down to Egypt, and we lived in Egypt a long time. And the Egyptians dealt harshly with us and our fathers, and when we cried to the Lord, he heard our voice and sent an angel and brought us out of Egypt. And here we are in Kadesh, a city on the edge of your territory, the edge of Edom's territory. So what I described earlier, Edom is down to the southeast part of the Dead Sea. Kadesh is kind of the southwest side. And Israel is coming out of Mount Sinai, coming out of their wandering, and they have to pass through Kadesh to get to Jerusalem. Now, if they stayed on that, I guess in your view, it'd be this side. If they stayed on this side of the Dead Sea to get to Jerusalem, they would have to go through Canaan. I think we all know the issue that's involved with Canaan. They were vulgar, awful people. And so they thought that they could find refuge in cutting down underneath the Dead Sea and going up through Edom and meeting Jerusalem at the top. And Edom knew that. And Edom is in the scripture basically saying no. A city on the edge of your territory, please let us pass through your land. They're begging. We will not pass through a field or vineyard or drink water from a well. We will go along the king's highway. Israel is saying, I will travel this king's highway. And that is basically where all the wars back then, most of them were fought, along that king's highway. For area, for goods, anything like that. That's where all the wars ended up happening. And Israel is basically saying, look, we'll just real quickly pass through and we'll even take the worst route. You don't even have to let us stay for very long. It says, we will go along the king's highway. We will not turn aside to the right hand or to the left until we have passed through your territory. But Edom said to them, you shall not pass through, lest I come out with a sword against you. These are brother nations, and they said no. And the people of Israel said to him, we will go up by the highway, and if we drink of your water, and I and my livestock, if by accident, if we just so happen to do it, we will pay you back in full Let me only pass through on foot, nothing more. But he said, he being Edom, you shall not pass through. And Edom came out against them with a large army and with a strong force. Thus Edom refused to give Israel passage through his territory. So Israel turned away from him. The Edomites were forcing Israel to take a huge risk upon their lives at that point in time because they were so prideful and selfish that they didn't want to share anything they had. This is almost like, I have a weird imagination, so just kind of go with it. This is like the first game of Red Rover, in my opinion. Edom comes out, and they basically are saying, if you come over, we're going to knock you down. That's all there's going to be to it. You will be knocked down. We read earlier in the scriptures, they would literally, Edom would go out into the crossroads. And basically what that means is when cities are fleeing from attack, they'd have to go down certain roads to escape. And Edom knew those routes, and they would stand there, and their armies would lock arms and keep those people from fleeing. Pretty brutal nation. And the whole idea there was that they wouldn't attack the people themselves, but they would hold people back and let them get attacked from behind. Even to the point of slaughter. So Edom would just stand there and allow these refugees to be slaughtered, even though they were begging for mercy. What's really cool about this book, and probably why I love it so much, is God is now getting in on this game of Red Rover. And he is calling out Edom. Red Rover, send Edom right over. That is the message that he is preaching to these people. And it's just like, I get goosebumps thinking about it. It's so awesome. Verses 1 and 2, I'm going to read them real quick again. It says, thus says the Lord God concerning Edom, we have heard a report from the Lord, and a messenger has been sent among the nations. Rise up, let us rise against her for battle. Behold, I will make you small among the nations. You shall be utterly despised. Obadiah literally says, we have heard a report. In the Greek, if you look up the word for that, it means tidings. And when I read that, I just kind of laugh to myself. I wrote LOL here on my notes. It's because when I think tidings, the first thing that comes to my mind, unfortunately, is that silly Christmas song. Oh, tidings of comfort. And congratulations. I'll be in your head the rest of the day. So, but we so often associate tidings with good news and happiness. And I think Obadiah is kind of being a smart aleck here, and he's like, hey, tidings, guess what? This is about to happen. And it does. And his little intro here has three parts. And the reason that we know that even though Obadiah is a nobody, we can trust him because his prophecy matches every other prophetic scripture in the Bible because of the format in which he writes it. There's three parts. First thing he says, his vision is from the Lord, literally says, thus says the Lord. And second part, it's concerning a nation, Edom. It says concerning Edom. And then third, God has sent a report to gather the nations against Edom. And he says a messenger, and that would be him. And that is typical prophetic scripture. If you look at Jonah, Nahum, Habakkuk, all those guys follow that exact same format. So even though we know literally nothing about this guy, we know he's legit. Verses 3 and 4, the pride of your heart has deceived you who live in the clefts of the rock, in your lofty dwelling, who say in your heart, who will bring me down to the ground? Though you soar aloft like the eagle, though your nest is set among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord. The Lord is declaring basically to them that the root cause of their destruction or their affliction that they're about to face and the judgment they will receive is because of the pride in their hearts. Something that we know very well, right? Pride that has deceived this nation into thinking she's so secure above the reaches of man, like an eagle soaring high in the sky and building its nest in the stars, as Obadiah puts it. They had a city that they lived in. So Edom was the territory. Teman was like the area, like we call this area, the riverbend. And then they lived in the city called Petra. And I wish I had pictures for you. My wife also thought this was cheesy, but I didn't want to make it like a PowerPoint presentation. They lived in the city very similar to what we see here. And they have, write it down, Petra, Google it later, the city of Petra, Bible times. They had one of the most outstanding nations built into the rocks. They literally had five-story buildings carved into the face of these clefts. And they would go in and they found way to send water and light, and they lived into, you can't even call it a cave because it was like a underground temple and city. And it was impossible for them to be attacked almost. And they spent so much time basically with the people that they captured and forced them like slaves to build the city for them. And it's just an amazing place. You gotta look it up. It's really, really cool. But God's message to them is simple. Edom will come down. Basically, he's saying you're done. Goodbye. See you later. I'm fed up. I can't take it anymore. You see, we may be able to escape the presence of man, but we are never going to escape the presence of God. And God is making that very clear to them. You see, back then, and even still today, Petra is one of the most highly regarded ancient cities that there could be. You can get in a plane, fly over there, drive up to the city, and walk in, and it's still there. But here's the problem. It's a tourist attraction. There's nobody there. It's abandoned, it's broken, it's desolate, and it literally is what God says here, stubble. It has, in essence, come down. See, pride makes us think that we are independent, self-sufficient, invulnerable people, but pride is simply based on a lie. The person who yields to the temptation of pride surrenders his capacity to think and feel and even act without deception. A complete ignorance is what the Bible calls it. We are overcome with a complete ignorance to who we are, what we've become, and the life that we're living. Pride will distort every area of your life, your mind, your heart, your family, you name it. Pride will destroy all of that. You see, most of the issues we have in life come from our own pride, not the issue itself. The issues that we face a lot of times are just a good mix of our pride in that issue. Because a lot of times if you take your own ideas or thoughts or emotions out of a situation, it'll probably just work its way out. I would say probably 90% of what we deal with is a pride issue, not an issue in itself. And I've learned that lesson a lot, and I think we all have. Luke told us that Jesus said, "What is exalted among men is an abomination to the Lord." I heard a story. Well, I read a story, I guess I should say. There's a man who just got a promotion, and he became vice president of his company, and everywhere he went, told everybody about it. And his wife finally got fed up with it, and she was like, "Congratulations, you're the VP. La-di-da. Everybody these days has a title like that." And so, of course, he's all mad and responds to her in a way he shouldn't, and she says, "I mean, for goodness sakes, there's even a vice president of peas down at the supermarket." And of course, he's like, no, there's no way. And his arrogance gets in the way. And so he calls down there, and he wants to just prove her so wrong. And he says, "I want to speak to the vice president of peas." And the lady says, "Fresh or frozen?" And that's funny and all, but here's my question to you about that. What are you exalting in your life that really means nothing? Is it your job? Is it your family? The money you make? Your talents? Your humility? Did you know you can be prideful of humility? I read that this week and it just smacked me in the face like a rock. It's kind of scary what pride can stick its head into. And It's a dirty, dirty thing. In verses 5 through 6, we see how thorough this destruction can be. It says, if the thieves came to you, if plunderers came by night, how you have been destroyed. Would they not steal only enough for themselves? If grape gatherers came to you, would they not leave gleanings? How Esau has been pillaged, his treasures sought out. God hates pride. It's simple. Simple, simple message. He abominates it. He loathes it. Whatever word you want to use, he does it. And the message we're seeing today is that not only does he do those things, but he will destroy it. The ruin that is about to come upon Edom is total, complete. It's not partial. Like what he says here, a grape gatherer or a thief may do. You see, a thief steals based on his needs most of the time. And a grape gatherer, a person, a thief, cannot steal or take everything. They can't come in and pillage you completely. It's just not physically possible. But God will leave nothing. Here God is getting very, very personal with these people, and when we apply it to ourselves, with us as well. He's not just judging the city. He's not judging their buildings or their area or anything like that, their jobs, their families. He's judging the people. And that's a scary, scary thing. But even more specific in this passage, the descendants of Esau. Don't ever let yourself think that you can sin because others are. Have we ever got to that point in our life? You see, because the reason that we can't get to that point is because God is morally perfect and he demands complete fairness and justice. Also, don't ever let yourself into a sin thinking that nobody will know or that you'll never get caught. Numbers 32 tells us that you can be sure that your sin will find you out. And when that happens, the justice of God, I promise, will not be fun. You know why I can promise that? Because I've faced it myself. When God judges you for your sin, whether it's now or later, it's going to be awful. It will not be fun. It won't be easy by any means. In fact, it's going to be destructive. To you, not to him. And why does it have to be that way? Because the God of the scriptures would be a liar if it wasn't that way. And so that's just what we have to live with. But it's not what we have to live with by ourselves. And that's the cool part about it. And we'll kind of get there in a little bit. God says in Romans 12:19, it is mine to avenge. And I will repay, says the Lord. I know this may not be one of the greatest ideas of hope or anything like that, but this enormous truth, this cause and effect relationship that we have with God is a must to point out and elaborate on. Verse 7. All your allies have driven you to your border. Those at peace with you have deceived you. They have prevailed against you. Those who eat your bread have set a trap beneath you. You have no understanding. Those who eat your bread, God is saying, those who you trust the most. You think everybody likes you? You're wrong. These people that you call your allies and your friends, the only reason they like you is because you can get things from them. Or for them, I should say. Because you're good for them in a bad way. That's the only reason they like you. The Edomites will have nowhere to turn, it says. They will have no allies to bank on when the judgment comes raining down on them. And what's funny is, he says right here, you have no understanding. God is saying, you don't even have a clue. You have no idea what's about to happen to you. Your pride is so big that I, the Lord, who let you have all this, am about to do something that you're going to hate. And they have no idea. They're just standing around acting cool. And Teman, these wise men of Teman are probably sitting up in a cleft of a rock thinking of a way to hurt Israel again. And they're just completely oblivious. They've become so self-involved that they don't even know what's going on in the world around them. How often do we get to that point? You know, one of the big fads these days is the older generations hate how the younger generations are caught up in social media and phones and all that. And they say you don't even know what's going on around you and stuff like that. But we do that in our life as well. Do you ever get caught up in your job to the point where you have no idea what's going on around you? Caught up in a relationship to the point that you have no idea what's going on in the world around you? There's a lot of things that we can get caught up in that force us to be into a lifestyle where we have no idea what's about to happen to us or the world that's around us. What we see in verse 7 is a fulfillment of what is said in verse 1. The tidings are sent among the people and among the nations to gather these other nations, and right now they're gathering. It's happening. It's about to go down, basically. Verse 8 and 9. Will I not on that day, declares the Lord, destroy the wise men out of Edom and understanding out of Mount Esau? And your mighty men shall be dismayed, O Teman, so that every man from Mount Esau will be cut off by slaughter. Teman was a grandson of Esau. So you have Isaac and Rebekah. They had twins, Esau and Jacob. Teman was Esau's grandson. So this is a very closely related relationship. And although it was only two generations removed, I think we all know they lived forever back then. So this could have been a span of a long time. But it was that close to Esau's original, I guess you could say sin, Esau's original plundering of God's truth. And so this is right here where we are, two generations removed. And they named this area after this man because they respected him so much. It was a very good, or highly regarded cultural and military center. And this is where the elite of the elite of both of those gathered. This was kind of like your Washington, D.C. of that area. They had all of the intellectuals up in this place, and that's where they gathered to do things that were unheard of to God's people. The best part of this, according to the world, they were awesome, but not to God. The beautiful part is God is basically saying, look, I'm not impressed or threatened at all by your military might or your intellectual prowess. I could care less. God's telling them that. All these things that you have to brag about, I'm going to tell you right now, it doesn't matter. And he tells them that. In fact, he will cut them off while they are being prideful about those things. Both the strong and the wise. So whatever you rely on, both of those things. This is especially significant because these warriors of Edom or the Teman area, they never before were terrified. They had no reason to be. This place that they lived in, they always had an unfair advantage in wars. There's a gorge that goes into the main opening of their city, and you can literally only file through it one by one, two, if you're lucky. And so if an army wanted to attack them, they had to come through a gorge, a canyon, one by one. These Edomites would just pick you off. It was literally impossible to destroy them. They didn't have bombs and stuff back then, so you couldn't sneak one in and get away with it. They were untouchable to the world. The attacks awaiting Edom that we see in here, the Old Testament, a lot of times people say God was so harsh, right? And we may think that this may look excessive or something like that, but All they do, this destruction, all it does is point to the divine nature of God and how awesome that is. If we look at God's fulfillment of his promises through Christ, it's the same way. Jesus died on one of the most significant torture devices of that time. And that moment was a supreme display, obviously, of God's mercy, but also of God's destruction. Because what you see what Jesus represented on that cross was our sin. And so often we just want to look at the beautiful part of that, although it all is beautiful, but to the world, the pretty part, that he died for us. But what it really means is that he took the weight of our sins on that cross, knowing full and well that he would be destroyed because of it. And so that promise to us is there. The promise that sin must and will be judged. Verses 10 through 14, we see how Edom's pride had shown itself at the point where her brother, or his brother, Israel, was at an all-time low. It says, because of the violence done to your brother, Jacob's shame shall cover you, and you shall be cut off forever. On the day that you stood aloof, on the day that strangers carried off his wealth, and foreigners entered his gates, and cast lots for Jerusalem, you were like one of them. But do not gloat. Listen, look at all the do nots in this scripture. All the things that they were doing wrong. Do not gloat over the day of your brother and the day of his misfortune. Do not rejoice over the people of Judah in the day of their ruin. Do not boast in the day of distress. Do not enter the gate of my people in the day of their calamity. Do not gloat over his disaster in the day of their calamity. Do not loot his wealth in the day of his calamity. Do not stand at the crossroads to cut off his fugitives. Do not hand over his survivors in the day of distress. Do not, do not, do not. That was the life that the Edomites were living, a life of do not. I don't really know what that means, but I said it, so take it for what it's worth. That's the life that they were in. And every moment of their life was wrong. They were in complete sin. And like we're seeing, God's fed up. Verse 10, because of the violence against your brother Jacob, you were like one of them. This issue goes so far back. Esau and Jacob fought in their mother's womb. In the womb of Rebekah, they fought. I don't even know how that's possible, but they did it. These twins either have a really bad relationship or a really good relationship. Have you ever noticed that? It's either really creepy close or like where they're wearing the same outfits everywhere and stuff like that, or it's awful. Sorry, Jeff. But that's just what it is. It's either good or bad, and this one was really bad. Every story that you can find in the Bible that involves one of these people is awful. I mean, there's no goodness that either one of them do for each other. From the moment of the womb until now, it's just been an ongoing fight. Esau and Jacob. And now we see the Edomites, who are descendants of Esau. And like I said earlier, although Edom never destroyed Israel or Judah on their own, they allowed them to be destroyed. And you might be sitting there going, how does this apply? I don't ever go out into the crossroads of nations and hold Syrian refugees back from escaping and letting them be slaughtered. That's not real life today. It might be. You see, we aren't out there holding our arms up doing that. But holding someone back from doing something that God has called them to do is just as bad. We stand there holding, how do you play Red Rover? I forgot. Like this? Okay. Sorry. We stand there like this, and we say such things as, I don't need to give to that mission. I don't need to support that cause. I don't need to tithe. That one probably hit a little sweet spot. Am I in trouble for saying that? If you treat tithing as just an Old Testament thing, then treat your sin as an Old Testament thing. And guess what's about to happen? You're going to get destroyed. I might have gone down a little rabbit trail there. Sorry. That rabbit could get pretty big. It might even start growing like deer antlers or something. But other things we may do. We stand there. I don't need to serve in that position at the church. I don't need to help that person. You see, although we're not holding refugees back and letting them get slaughtered, we do hold people back. People of God, more importantly. And that's scary. It really is. You see, sin not only includes what we do against God, but also what we refuse to do for God. Did you know that? Just because you're not out doing something completely erroneous or whatever, you could be stealing yourself from doing something for God. And God sees that as sin. Over and over in the Bible, we see that someone or anyone who does not help God's people, you know what he calls them? An enemy of God. Proverbs 29 tells us, even if one stands aside and watches injustice, like the Edomites standing to the side, without raising a voice, one shares with the instigator in the wrongdoing. You share in that sin, in that destruction of God's people. And that's not something you want to share. Verse 11, they cast lots for Jerusalem. Does that ring any bells in your head? The casting of lots? You see, this prophecy is so, so deep. Jesus on the cross had his garments torn off, and they casted lots for his stuff. The fulfillment of God's promise to save us through Christ's death at that point in time when they casted lots correlates perfectly, physically and spiritually, with this story and how it his promises can fulfill the saving of the nation of Judah. It's perfect. It says they stood aloof. Anybody know what the word aloof means? I had to look it up. They stood aloof. When a person is in the bondage of pride, they always seek to exalt themselves over others. Whether it's a nation, a group, adults, children, even anything. They seek to exalt themselves over others. And when we're apart from the grace of God, not only will we do that, but we'll find pleasure in doing it. Finding pleasure in other people's failures is not something that God's willing to accept. How often do you find yourself rejoicing at the misfortune of others? That may be hard to think of an example, but I bet if you think hard enough, you could find one. Why do we do it? Personally, I think it tends to help with the pain of our own inadequacies. Seeing somebody else fail or suffer, maybe, in something that maybe we tried to do at some point, makes us feel better about ourselves. I mean, isn't that the point? To live a happy, go lucky, feel good life? And we'll find it wherever we can. Edom stood and relished in this destruction of Judah. It says she stood aloof, she gloated, she boasted, she looted, and she ran after them. All those things she did. And we do the same things. Obadiah is not stupid. He knew that they were guilty, I guess you could say. He knew that they too had their own faults and failures. But he also knew that the time had come for Edom. And justice is about to rain down. I read a commentator, a preacher said, what should Edom have done here? I couldn't have come up with that question, nor the answer. What should they have done? And he said, we know because Jesus taught us. We know that they should have looked upon the judgment of their brother and shuddered. They should have humbled themselves. They should have been sitting there thinking we would be incredibly stupid to allow ourselves to fall into the same thing that Judah is right now in exile for, and begging for our passage for an escape. They're begging us for that. We should be stupid to think that we could allow ourselves to get to that point. That's how they should have been thinking. But obviously not. He went on to say that there was a story where some people in Luke, where some people came running to him to gossip about the misfortunes of others. And you know what Jesus' response was? Jesus is really good at responses. I don't know if you've ever noticed that. He said, do you really think that those people were worse sinners than you? Verses 15 and 16, God reveals to Obadiah that nothing will go unpunished. He says, for the day of the Lord is near upon all nations. As you have done, it shall be done to you. Your deeds shall return on your own head. For as you have drunk on my holy mountain, so all nations shall drink continually. They shall drink and swallow and shall be as though they had never been. Obadiah is preaching revelation straight from God and seeing that the day of the Lord is coming. And the day of the Lord will be terrible and beautiful. There will be two people, two different types of people on the day of the Lord. And for some, it's going to be awful. But for some, it's going to be glorious. Zephaniah 1, 14 through 15 says, basically, this is a summation of it, the great day of the Lord is near, near and coming quickly. The cry on the day of the Lord is bitter. The mighty warrior shouts his battle cry. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of trouble and ruin, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and blackness. The song we sang this morning, He Reigns, it said the powers of darkness cannot drown out God. The darkness that is so relevant in this, the bitter wrath, distress, anguish, trouble, ruin, darkness, gloom, clouds, blackness, all those things Zephaniah says. And it's all because of pride. That is the fruit of pride. He doesn't just distinguish here between the immediate judgment of Edom and the judgment of the day of the Lord. You see, in his eyes, in Nahum's eyes, in Habakkuk's eyes, in Jonah's eyes, all those prophets, the day of the Lord is an ongoing process. Because in our lives, getting to that point is a process. And he's not speaking specifically on one little thing here. The Edomites basically will not boast forever. That's basically the first part, and it's the longest part, so don't worry. Edom will come down for her pride and her violence. The message that we can take from that is the proud will reap what they sow. Sin brings its inevitable result, and he who sows shall also reap. Galatians 6:7 says, "Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows." Verse 15 says, "As you have done, it shall be done to you. Your deeds shall return on your own head. If we choose in our pride to live without God, he will grant us that independence, that freedom." God doesn't force us to follow him. And what really will stink is when you get to the real day of the Lord, when he returns, you're still going to have that freedom. God's not going to stand up for you if you chose to have that freedom. His righteousness will not abound in you. You will not be saved from that wrath and that destruction. And that is by far the scariest message of the Bible, is being free from God on the day of judgment and what that entails. So that's through 16 there. And I know that you're probably sitting there thinking, geez, what an awful, depressing sermon, right? But one of my favorite people of the Lord, I guess you could say, he was a preacher, and he used to say, and some people get this reference, it gets gooder, okay? So right now it's about to get gooder. Verses 17 through 21, Obadiah assures the people of Judah that there will be a day of escape, a day of the Lord, and God has made a way for them. It says very literally in verse 17, "In Mount Zion there shall be those that escape, and it shall be holy." Now, we've already talked about this, but Judah went into exile for its own pride and sin, and Edom is going to experience the same exact thing. Can we not ask ourselves or come to the conclusion that escape is something that's not just for Judah? It's not just because they're Jews. This escape that he provides is for everyone. And the way that it directly correlates with Jesus on the cross, the story is that we have that same escape in him. He's provided that same exact way of escape for us. God hates pride, I already said, but he also loves humility. And he will accept those who become humble, those who live by faith. The second part of this story here is the promise in the comfort that if we live by faith in God, we have a way of escape. Because that judgment's coming whether we like it or not, to everybody. And if we live in that comfort and in that faith, we will have that comfort. And that's the promise of the gospel. Verses 17 through 21 are the redemption process of this story. In verse 18, it's a pretty stark contrast to the gloomy part of the first part when he says, literally, the house of Jacob shall be a fire, and the house of Joseph a flame. Things that represent light, the opposite of darkness. These promised people of God will be a light. And in fact, he says Esau is just going to be stubble. That's it, just little rocks. Verse 19 says the Negev. The Negev are people, the refugees, basically, of Judah. Jewish refugees, God's chosen people. And at the end of verse 19 and 20, we see God's people are reclaiming what is theirs. It's coming full fruition. The promises that were made a long time ago are finally being played out in their life. And the promise that we have there is that the promises made to Isaac, Benjamin, Jacob are also made to us. That escape and that fulfillment will happen at some point. And it may not be today, it may not be tomorrow, it may not be anywhere near where we want it to be, but we will receive fulfillment of that promise. God's promises are full and final. The word for occupy or possess is used 7 times in this series of verses here. A number that represents what? Perfection. Can only come to the conclusion that God's fulfillment is perfect. He was perfecting his promise to his people. You see, unlike them, we have the pleasure of reading the New Testament. They didn't have that. All their faith was in the prophets. It would be pretty hard to have faith in God if all you read was doom and gloom all the time, right? But we get the New Testament. And we can see that the fulfillment of this prophecy and of the redeemed people in this reclaimed land and whatever you want to call it is much bigger than what Obadiah is saying here to the Edomites. We know that the people of God will be part of his kingdom on earth. And God is building that kingdom in this passage. Galatians 3 says, there's neither Jew nor Greek, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. So the people who are going to inherit the promise are not just Jews who are faithful, but they are also the whole church of God, the church that is sitting in this building today. The churches around the nation that are meeting right now. All of us share in that. The land is also much bigger than what Obadiah saw. Paul said that the descendants of Abraham shall inherit the world. You know, what's really cool is when Edom told them, no, you can't come through our land, and they had to cut over and go up, guess what happened? They won that battle. And Gad and Reuben, some of you may know who that is, 2 representatives of the 12 tribes of Israel, got to take over those areas. So God not only brings them to this place, and Edom's like, no, you're not coming through. So God kills them, destroys them. But also, while the Israelites have to go around, they're super sad about it, he gives them another fulfillment and another victory. And they defeat an army that they probably should not have defeated. All because it's all coming to fruition. And God is setting up his kingdom here on earth. And there's nothing that can stop that. And that's the promise that we have there. Do you really think that God's kingdom here on earth in those days is going to be a little dry patch of land where Edom used to be? No, not at all. Psalm teaches us that the kingdom belongs to the Lord and he rules over those nations. And all the proud shall bow down. Israel obviously will have their own province, and we are taught that, but so will we. We all share in that inheritance. You see, those who have fled from the wickedness of pride into the holiness of humility will receive that promise and find refuge in Zion, in God, in the day of the Lord. If you only hear one thing today, I really, really want you to hear this, and this is where I'll end. Hopefully. Those of us who believe in him and who are in Christ, our end time judgment has already taken place. That is the promise that we get from Jesus on the cross. And that's what this whole message is. Getting back to Jesus. And we are here now looking at that message that we no longer have to worry about facing destruction. It's already happened. He took it from us. And not only did he take it, he took it willingly. He didn't have to. He wanted to. And my prayer for you is that you leave this place today knowing that the destruction that you could face if you are of faith has already happened. And we shouldn't walk around tiptoeing through life worrying about things. And we shouldn't be prideful in the things that we can amass in this world. Because there's no reason for it. We've already conquered through him. The song that we're about to sing, I think, unless we do it like we did before, is just a closer walk. As you leave this place today, the way that you can achieve that closer walk is to know the fact that your destruction is gone. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for your scriptures and for the truths that are in them. Father, we pray that as we leave today that you are ready and willing to stand beside us as we go through the different facets of our life that provide areas where we may fall into pride. God, we pray that you destroy that pride in us, no matter how easy or hard it will be, and allow us to become a church full of humility and full of you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Like Nick said, this next song that we'll be doing, right? Just a closer walk? All right, that's why I got nervous there. Isaiah 26:9 says, "My soul yearns for you in the night. My spirit within me earnestly seeks you. For when your judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world learn righteousness." Just made me think of the word yearn. This is the song that made me think of yearn. Do I yearn for God? Do I even yearn for his judgments so I can learn repentance and righteousness? And the thing is, only he can take away our sins, and he really yearns for our hearts. So we're going to stand up and sing. And let's let him know that we yearn for his as well.
Keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk, dear Lord, close to thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Now through this world of toil and snares, if I falter, Lord, who time for me will be
Tell I haven't done this before. I took my mic off. Sorry. The benediction today, I can't say it better than that song did. We know the God who goes before us, and we have angel armies on our side. So let's go ahead and receive this benediction today. God, we thank you that we no longer are slaves to the fear, to fear of the unknown, to fear of destruction, to fear of being without you. God, because we know that you go before us, that you find us. And when we find you, those angel armies are on our side. So as we leave here today, God, I pray that we can walk in the truth, in the humility, in the promise that we have those angel armies with us. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. I got a couple announcements, sorry. These are due next week. I don't know if you guys take them. That's all I'm going to say about that. Also, tonight we have summer kickoff party, I think that's what it's called, at Haskell Park. It's not just us, but we also help do games and food and stuff like that. And that's from 5 to 6:30, and then I think the Muni Band starts tonight as well. I'm not sure, and I'll be directly after. So 5 to 6:30, they got a little party thing going on at the park. If you want to help with that, you're more than welcome. We'll take it all day long. So see me or see somebody about that afterwards. Have a good day.